No, my name's Sophie Lieberman and I'm the Head of Programs for Sydney Living Museums, and it's my great pleasure to welcome you to the Museum of Sydney for our annual Museums and Galleries New South Wales seminar. As we begin, I'd like to acknowledge the Gadigal people on whose land we meet and pay my respects to Indigenous elders past and present. Sydney Living Museums and Museums and Galleries New South Wales have been collaborating for some years now. I don't know how many exactly, but at least a decade, on the presentation of an annual seminar to reflect the issues that are relevant to our sector. This year, we're turning our attention to impact. As museums and galleries continue to seek to extend their relevance to new audiences and communities in a connected global context, the question of impact, how we interpret and measure the success or failure of how we achieve our mission, continues to grow. Today we're going to hear five presentations that view impact for the museums and galleries sector through different lenses. We'll find out how it's interpreted and understood by researchers, policymakers, funders, museum staff, and artist practitioners. One of the ways that I consider we can improve our impact is through collaboration. And I'd like to take this particular moment to thank Michael Rolfe, Jane Gillespie and Andrew Brettel and the rest of the museums and galleries staff for their collaboration in these seminars over so many years. Sydney Living Museums really values that relationship and the way that it allows us to support and expand on the issues and conversations that are so important to our industry. I'll hand you over in a second to Michael, who will be emceeing you, but a tiny bit of housekeeping first. If you could switch your devices to silent. The hashtag today is Museum Impact. I knew it. So please share the conversation beyond this room and beyond the afternoon. There'll be afternoon tea about 2:55. If you need the loos then or before, please go down the stairs and turn all the way around to your left. And we're also recording today, so if during Q&As you could wait for the handheld mic, we'd really like to be able to capture your voice as well as those of the presenters. So thanks to you all for coming, and it's with great pleasure that I introduce the CEO of Museums and Galleries New South Wales, Michael Rolfe. Michael.
Thanks, Sophie, and welcome guests. And thanks to the speakers for giving their time and being here with us this afternoon. I also, of course, want to acknowledge Sydney Living Museums as partners and Museum of Sydney in particular for providing this theatre as the venue. In particular, Mark Goggin, Sophie Lieberman, Amy Eastwood and James Murray for their assistance in organising technical and logistical support that makes this event possible. We're going to have five presentations, and there'll be two 20-minute ones, then a short break, and then a further three, followed by a question and answer opportunity. As Sophie mentioned, we're filming tonight, and we're also, this afternoon, sorry, and we're also streaming live on YouTube. So be polite, yeah? Get yourself known, too. The hashtag, Sophie's covered that. And I think it's important now that I introduce Auntie Faye Carroll, who from the Wallamulla Family and Community Support Centre in Woolloomooloo, who's come along to perform and provide a welcome to country for you. Thank you.
Wow, that was a long one, wasn't it? Good afternoon. I'm very honoured and pleased to be with you this afternoon. Thank you very much for your kind invitation for me to come and do the Welcome to Country, which tells me that people such as yourself are now acknowledging my culture and the Welcome to Country to be done at different venues. I would now like to pay my respects to the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation, to our elders both past and present. I would also like to pay respects to both Aboriginal and non-Aboriginal people here today and to welcome you on the country. Welcome to the land of the Gadigal people. Have a great afternoon and I hope to see you again next year. Thank you.
Thank you, Auntie Faye. It's now my pleasure to introduce Dr. Jodie Evans from the Melbourne Business School, University of Melbourne. Jodie is Associate Professor in Marketing at the Melbourne Business School, and she also has extensive experience as a consultant and as an executive educator for organisations in the retail and arts sectors. Current projects examine a range of issues, including best practice models of economic and social impact in the visual arts, the role of arts and culture in regenerating city brand image, building audiences for Indigenous arts, and developing a collective impact approach to engaging Indigenous and migrant communities in creative practice. Jodie's on the board of the Public Galleries Association of Victoria and also the board of Shepparton Art Museum Foundation. So it's a great pleasure to welcome Jodie back to Sydney and to one of our events.
Sorry. I think I started this year intending to say no to things. And I think that was my first conversation with Michael in January, was I'm going to start the year by saying no. But I can just never say no to opportunities like this to engage with the museums and gallery sector about the sort of work that we're doing. And this is a picture actually of the Shepparton Art Museum and a specific program that runs there that focuses on refugee communities and using the role of art and arts practice as a tool for social inclusion and for developing a shared understanding of the community within Shepparton. And it's a really impactful program, and it's one I'm going to talk a little bit about today. I think when we talk about impact, part of it is recognising that this is a new narrative for the sector now, and that there's many factors driving this focus on impact, but certainly when you look at the land of philanthropy and stakeholder engagement, government funding, this is the language that we're now hearing. It's not just about donations, it's not just about charity. Philanthropic trusts are increasingly wanting to demonstrate their own impact for their giving. So we've got this move towards catalytic change and impactful philanthropy. And that's really spurred the sector on, I think, to focus increasingly on how they can demonstrate and share the impact that many arts organisations have. When we talk about impact, there's really two main purposes for even focusing on it as an organisation. And the first is really about improving the organisation's ability to meet its objectives. And impact, we talk about it as assessment, not measurement. So this is really about assessing how an organisation is tracking and how this relates to the sort of objectives and even shaping the objectives for an arts organisation. The second purpose for impact assessment really relates to its communication ability, that by being able to capture and document your impact, you're then able to use that as a meaningful basis for engaging stakeholders in much more constructive and powerful conversations. So when we talk about impact, and particularly impact in the arts, it's not saying that every organisation has to have the same impact. There's a lot of different ways that arts organisations can contribute to their communities, both economically and socially. And I think it's important that we're not too prescriptive in telling arts organisations that you have to win on every single one of these factors. But it is important for arts organisations to be mindful now and to have a high degree of mindfulness when crafting strategies and planning programs about what sort of impact you are seeking to have. Impact doesn't just happen. So this is something that really needs to be planned for and needs to be part of those strategic conversations within arts organisations. So rather than just tracking it at the end of a program, what we would like to see is that objectives around these sources of impact, whether it's around things like visitor expenditure, certainly the economic growth and development of regional communities is one that arts organisations can meaningfully contribute to. There are sort of things that often are quantitatively measured. But what we're also really, really interested in, and what I think the arts should prioritise, is its social impact. Much harder to measure, but much more meaningful in terms of the contribution and demonstrating the value of arts organisations. And so when we're talking about social impact, the arts can play significant roles in social inclusion, contribution to mental health, civic pride and community identity. And I think also we should never, ever underplay the importance of the intrinsic impact of the arts on audiences and that personal impact that it can have on people's lives. So I think there's a need for museums and galleries to really take some control about the impact conversation and to avoid a situation where we end up having metrics imposed on the sector. So this is a time for organisations to step up and really take a leadership role in the conversation around impact. So when we started researching the economic and social impact in specifically in the visual arts sector in Victoria, what our research revealed was that there were three really big drivers that were pushing this focus on impact for visual arts organisations. The first is what everybody's facing, this incredibly competitive funding climate, where certainly from the perspective of philanthropic trusts and government funders, they're getting more and more asks for funding. So they're having to find new ways to distinguish between who they're going to fund and who they're not. And part of the drive for that focus on impact is coming from the funding bodies around wanting to know what they're investing in and that what they're investing in is beyond just one specific program and it's about what it's going to contribute for a community. The other major driver is around government support. And I think it's always important to remember that government perspective that they're responsible for handing out public money. And so I think sometimes we can get a little bit whingy, a bit negative about having to fill out forms for government and answer their questions. But there's a huge onus on government at the moment around funding arts and culture. I think it's often a hard battle to win in the media to make voters care about arts and culture when they're worried about health and education. So for arts organisations to be able to demonstrate their impact, that helps government demonstrate its return on the investment of government money. So the public deriving benefit from public institutions is a natural thing that we should all be focused on. The third main driver really comes from external stakeholders, and this is everything from government agencies, but to also media, corporate sponsors and supporters, that they're really, really interested in engaging in interesting stories. And that's what impact can do for an arts organisation, is give you a platform to have a conversation about the really interesting things that you already do, but maybe you just haven't crafted the story in the right way. So when we look at impact in the project that we did in Victoria last year, we adopted a logic model approach. This is a pretty simple assessment framework, if you like, that can be embedded in organisations that sets you on a path to naturally focusing on not just measurement, but more a focus on evaluation and reflection and the narrative that can come from knowing what worked with on this impact project. So we actually partnered with four organisations, the Bendigo Art Gallery, the Shepparton Art Museum, the Linden Centre for Contemporary Art, and also Arts Project Australia. So four Victorian visual arts organisations. Part of the reason we focused on Bendigo was that certainly within the Victorian climate, there was this factor called the Bendigo factor. And there was huge pressure on arts organisations in Victoria to do a Bendigo, become a Bendigo. And part of what we wanted to do in this project was to unpack what's enabled Bendigo to have the impact and the cut through that it has. And so when we look at something like the Bendigo Art Gallery, I think it's important that the art gallery story is not one of blockbuster exhibitions. That's just one tool in a whole repertoire of programming and activities and exhibitions that the art gallery actually does. Bendigo Art Gallery's real impact is around what it's done for civic pride in Bendigo and how that civic pride has in turn led to fantastic growth in the region's development and infrastructure. When we unpack the impact that Bendigo's had, a really key input into that has been the leadership. And it's actually something that we found across all four case studies that we looked at. Was certainly Karen Quinlan, as the director of the Bendigo Art Gallery, her personal leadership qualities and her ambition for what this small regional art gallery could do I think that personal ambition has been a major driver in what's led to the success for the art gallery. But the other interesting factor that's contributed is a really key input in the success of Bendigo Art Gallery is the unique structure and relationship between the art gallery and the council. So for many art galleries in local government, they report into community development. Bendigo Art Gallery doesn't. So it reports into a structure within the council that is focused on events and tourism and investment and growth. And having that sort of relationship has really enabled the council and the community within Bendigo to see the art gallery as a very powerful lever for many, many growth opportunities in the region. That unique structure changes the conversation that Karen can have within council and already raises the profile of the gallery within the council's agenda. When it comes to the sort of exhibitions and programming, a big part of Bendigo's success is about the quality international shows that they bring. That these are big name shows that are bringing amazing collections to a regional community. So I was lucky to be at the opening a few weeks ago of the British Museum show and bringing these phenomenal, iconic images to Australia, let alone to a small town in Australia, is a really huge achievement. And it is partly those international shows that bring the profile for the art gallery. But those shows and what they bring also then gives the gallery the scope and opportunity to do a lot of other programming that's equally important for community. So I think it's important that we don't just think that all Bendigo does is put on a big blockbuster every now and then. That there's a lot of community-specific programming that is also underpinning its success. And then, of course, you can't talk about the gallery without talking about the outputs and the outcome. And this is where there's real power in demonstrating impact, and with Grace Kelly alone generating $16 million for the greater Bendigo region, what a fantastic outcome for a gallery to say, look at what we did for our community. But it's also what those numbers then enable the gallery to do. That this changes the way people think about their community. And that's partly what the international shows have done for the art gallery and the community in Bendigo, is this notion of community identity. And I love this quote, that civic pride is what lifts a city and a community aspiration. It's a very powerful thing. It's an intangible that is equally as powerful. And you can't totally quantify it, but you can't tell me it's not powerful. It's what distinguishes you from other regional cities. And this is what the art gallery's really done for Bendigo. People are now proud to say they come from Bendigo. The statistics on the livability and people's desire to move to Bendigo, for young people to stay and study there instead of moving to Melbourne, all of this is what the art gallery has actually contributed to. That people have a sense of pride because of the art gallery, even if they haven't been. So a lot of the locals still don't necessarily go to the art gallery. Proud to say that they're from a community that has the Bendigo Art Gallery. And that role of pride has led to a real willingness for small business to invest again in the community. View Street, which is the street that the gallery faces, used to be an absolute dump. It was really desolate. It was a sad, sad part of Bendigo. And now it is incredibly lively. There's fantastic cafes, there's shops, there's small businesses who are willing to invest. After the White Wedding Dress show and then Grace Kelly, we talk about a particular bra store in Bendigo, tiny little outlet, and now women come all the way from Melbourne to be fitted in Bendigo because they experienced it when they came for the show. And the council talk about the shows and women getting off the train and walking up the street from the train station to the art gallery, and that they come and they hunt in packs because they come and they spend. And that's a really important contribution to a regional community, is bringing those dollars into the community and then the multiplier effect of that spend. The other story to tell you is a different one. Sam is incredibly close to my heart. So I'm now on the Sam Foundation board, and we're charged with basically raising about $40 million in funding to build a new and much larger Shepparton Art Museum. But Sam's a lot smaller than Bendigo, so smaller rate base in the community, smaller art gallery, and a very different mandate for its purpose in the community. And Sam is an incredibly important figure in the Shepparton community in the role it plays in social cohesion. So Shepparton is an incredibly depressed environment, if you like. So we've got the second biggest Indigenous community outside of Melbourne in Victoria, facing about 80% unemployment. You've also got a huge refugee and migrant population. So from very diverse countries, from the Sudan to Afghani refugees who've made the struggle to get all the way to Australia and then they're dumped in Shepparton, which is about 2.5 hours from Melbourne. Very little English language to start with, and then you've also got an agricultural economy that is really facing a struggle, and obviously SPC's been in the news quite a bit, and what the canning industry and the fruit production industry is going through in that region. So Shepparton as a region is having tough times, and this is the role that the arts can play in those sorts of communities as well, that when we look at the Shepparton Art Museum, part of its success has come from the fact that a few key figures in the community recognise the value of the arts and what the arts can do for people who are facing real hardship. And it's these few supporters who've been able to galvanise the local government's interest in SAM, and the council, combined with Regional Development Victoria, have committed $250,000 to the feasibility study of the new museum. And I think that commitment and recognition comes from that importance of community leadership and backing of an art museum. When we look at SAM, part of what makes it so valuable is the programming that happens there. The Shepparton Art Museum has the largest ceramics collection in Australia, but it's how they use that collection and the sort of programs within communities where they're using art as a tool for social inclusion that has really led to huge improvements in this community and reducing that sense of social isolation. What we also know with SAM is, with some really clever acquisition choices, it's been able to generate huge interest in the community. This one figure alone of Woman and Child had over 17,000 visitors to the Shepparton Art Museum. And then this was on a loan, and in the end the community loved it so much that, combined with council and some philanthropic support, they raised the funds to buy this piece for the community. This is a really iconic image now for the Shepparton community around the power of what they can do. And this one figure of Woman and Child has been used across so many different migrant communities to show that commonality of the human journey, that it doesn't matter where you come from, this is quite a universal image. And this one Sam Jinx acquisition has really bolstered people's interest in the museum, and a sense that the art museum is a place that you can go, that it's not intimidating, you're not going to get the answer wrong, but this is a place that you can really connect with your community. When we look at that, part of what we see for the Shepparton Art Museum is particularly the role that it's played in its partnerships and collaborations with the local Indigenous artists and supporting the development of an Indigenous art gallery and studio where they're able to practice their own culture and also share and transfer that culture through the generations, and the important role that this has played in the mental health of the Indigenous community, and also what it's done in terms of their sense of self-esteem. So when we talk about SAM, in a town where employment is an issue, where the canning industry is in deep shit, where primary industry is in trouble, where there's a water policy, Shepparton to me sort of encapsulates just about everything that's going on in Australia. And while the arts won't solve every problem, it will make a real contribution in every one of those areas, tourism and economics and social. And I think that's a fantastically exciting opportunity. And that quote comes from a major philanthropist who is backing the new Shepparton Art Museum. And I think that's what an impact story can do, is galvanise that interest and support from a range of stakeholders to then magnify that impact and take a museum to the next level. So when we talk about impact, I think it's important not to be afraid about measurement, not to let the debate be hijacked by concerns of measurement. That it's really about using a focus on impact to assess what you're doing and then using that as the basis for a new narrative and a new story for an art museum to tell rather than just constantly telling what programs we're doing, what activities we have, how many people came through the door. This is the new narrative for museums and galleries, and this is a narrative that's really going to engage quite a diverse range of stakeholders. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Jody. I'm now going to introduce Dr. Caroline Butler-Bowden and Julie Turpey from Sydney Living Museums. Caroline is Assistant Director, Creative Services for the Sydney Living Museums, where she directs the cross-platform programming in the fields of interpretation, exhibitions, public programs, education, web and digital, volunteering, online collections and publications for the portfolio's 12 museums and historic houses. Julie is Assistant Director, Commercial and Marketing Services at Sydney Living Museums. She oversees the implementation of marketing and communication strategies to grow audiences, increase revenue, and build brand awareness and value for Sydney Living Museums while ensuring that the brand strategy is realised and executed as envisioned across all the organisational touch points. So it's a great pleasure to welcome both Caroline and Julie. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Michael, and thanks to Museums and Galleries New South Wales. We're delighted to be here and see you all here at one of our Sydney Living Museums. Well, impact is clearly the word of the day, isn't it? There's a SAMAG session on Monday night about philanthropy, passion, strategy and impact. So it's a word that's having impact at the moment. There we go. It's obviously because of being in an environment, whether we're in a small museum or a much larger museum institution such as ours, that has now fewer resources, challenging budget times, obviously, you know, a lot of competition in a city like Sydney. Things like shopping malls now doing programming along with pubs and clubs, the restaurant scene getting more creative. So really to make that impact, we need to be sharper, more creative, clearly more collective in our thinking and more collaborative to make that greater impact. And really for an institution such as ours, it's about growing our fan base. It's about people really wanting to make us their number one institution that they come to again and again. And that's how we start kind of broadening our base. So today we're not talking sort of generally about value and other sorts of things. We're looking at one particular program in what is a large suite of programming across our 12 sites. And it's called Home and Architecture, and we launched it in April this year. It's still ongoing, we're only a few months in, but we thought it would be a good exercise for today to show some of that, how we've measured and certainly how we've assessed some of that impact. And also to show what has been the behind the scenes thinking that's got us to that point. So just setting the scene, these are the 12 that we manage. They aren't the year those properties were built, you will have worked out. They're the times when we acquired those properties. So we have evolved enormously in the past 30 years since we were set up. So obviously it's all about mission. If Sydney Living Museums disappeared tomorrow, what hole would it leave for our community? So reminding ourselves in every single thing that we do is what we offer. We care for and we're deeply passionate about those 12 sites, including this one, those 12 museums and the stories of the people who live there, as well as the story of the built fabric. And our purpose is about how do we connect with everyone, your life, in terms of what's happening in your world, in terms of your home, architecture and the rest of it. So that's what we'll be looking at. And then the ultimate goal is really that we want these museums to be there for our children's children and so on. How do we just be custodians and stewards of them so that they are there for a long time going into the future? hand over to you, Trolley. We're doing a bit of a tag team.
Go. We're partners in crime today. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Julie Turpey, and thank you to museums and galleries for having myself and my colleague Caroline here today. I suppose a little bit of the backstory in terms of how did we get to Sydney Living Museums. We obviously, as Historic Houses Trust, were formed back in 1980, and around sort of 3 years ago, we identified that we really needed to look at our offer and our invitation to both existing and to new audiences, and looking at how we obviously maintain that balance of conservation and preservation, which is absolutely core to our organisation, but how did we actually extend an invitation? So we embarked upon what has led us to Sydney Living Museums, and that project started with a competition. Really looked to understand, well, who are our audiences, firstly, and what do they understand about us, and what is their awareness, and what are their perceptions? So where we got to with that, which then really became the catalyst and the springboard, I suppose, to our brand positioning, was there was awareness of HHT, there was certainly awareness of our individual properties, but not as a collective. And I think, we have come from a place where sometimes having 12 front doors has been a challenge, but really now we really identify that there is an opportunity for us. We have 12 ways in which we can engage with our audiences and with communities. And this is a real opportunity and not a hurdle. So we also understood that some of our audiences had perhaps not a lower awareness, and the perception of what we did was very traditional, and that perhaps things hadn't changed since they last visited our properties, perhaps as a school kid. So we worked very closely internally across our staff, our stakeholders, our volunteers, our foundation and trustees, in terms of embedding and creating a brand positioning across the whole organisation. This wasn't something that those creative folk in marketing did. This brand needed to be owned by the whole organisation. So we have come up with the core idea of experience a whole other life, and we have created our four brand values and brand pillars. So firstly, about being a sociable home. We have 12 houses, and even the Justice and Police Museum was a home of sorts to some people. So if you come to our home, we need our staff to be a sociable host. You need to be welcomed into our properties. And again, this was a way of instilling and embedding the brand across the organisation, that every single member of Sydney Living Museums represents our brand. We're authentically resourceful, so we hold collections in our properties that no one else may hold, and how do we repurpose and bring those collections to the fore, and how are we showing practices and hobbies and that haven't been seen before, and how do we bring them into the modern day? About being personally fascinated. So yes, the architecture, the construction, and the materials of our 12 properties are extremely significant, but who are the people that lived in them? What happened to those people? What are their stories? And that is the connecting point for communities and visitors to our properties today. How do I connect with these properties? And also about reviving, so I've touched on that in terms of how do we bring back practices that we are seeing sort of through blogs and online knitter groups, etc., that are becoming really popular.
So part of the extension of doing all the audience research and the ushering in of the new brand was, of course, that there's no point if the outside of what's on the can looks different to what's on the inside. So we really kind of took what we were doing that was good, but also started to embellish that and really kind of have a long, hard look at our audience strategy, and as part of that, for the first time, a digital strategy for the organisation. And that, of course, I think we had more workshops in that year before last than we've ever had in terms of really kind of trying to bring people on board and really listen to people and understand what we wanted to achieve. So part of it was, you know, we've just sort of completed the first year of what is really for the next 2 years about how can we unite what is the programming offer with obviously the museums themselves and the business offer. So it is about customer service, the sociable host. We had to kind of really go back to basics and really kind of ask questions and filter what we were doing. The linking across sites, a lot of people knew our properties individually, but they didn't connect the dots. We weren't actually taking people from one property if they'd loved their experience at Vaucluse House, what were we doing to encourage them to go to Elizabeth Farm or vice versa? And obviously those connections through food and beverage and retail. So obviously we're only 1 year in, we've still got a long way to go, and it was great to hear Jodie in terms of the kind of community strategy. We're still in the kind of early days of that, and Sophie will be leading a lot of that conversation in the year to come, in the years to come. So what were our ultimate outcomes? Really about becoming better known, better understood, and just improving people's awareness of us. Always about becoming less reliant on government funding, so how can we become more sustaining, and what are those active partnerships that we can develop that help us, you know, become less reliant on government. Growing our visitation, of course, by being more focused, so not doing more necessarily, but doing what we do better, linking our museums through those incentives for repeat visitation. One of the things we've done is usher in a city pass. It sounds very straightforward, but it connects our four city properties, and our visitation has really, really gone up, particularly at the smaller museum like Susanna Place. So the encouragement of somebody buying a pass here at Hyde Park Barracks for $15, they get all four of the properties. And then really about that lens, what is that filter? How do we make the decisions on what we're doing? These were eight simple questions that we now look at when we're looking at proposals or other sorts of ideas, whether they come from outside or they're self-generated. And they're quite simple questions, and they were quite simple on purpose. Will whatever we're talking about bring in more people? Will it bring in different people? Does it fit with those brand signatures? Will it increase accessibility in our museums? The ever important increase our revenue? Will it deepen people's understandings of understanding of one of our 12 museums? People who've lived there for generations? Will it make a difference, that social impact question? And how does it connect us better with our communities? And part of this was that we embarked on a digital strategy with Pure and Applied, which was a really fascinating journey for us. Like working with Frost, it was holding a mirror up to us as an organisation. We didn't always like what we saw. We liked some parts. But this was really about what are our ambitions and goals and values, you know, what are those assets that we've got, and what is the outreach and the engagement to connect with the different audiences? And really critically, what is the content? You know, our website and our digital engagement isn't just a marketing tool. That's one small bit of it. But what is the content, and how are we engaging others in that? And of course, how do we, out of one creative program, reach to across multiple platforms with reduced staff? So if we're thinking about an exhibition or public program, what is the online engagement? What is the other sorts of things? And that's where we'll talk about home and architecture. So we've got a new look website that we launched in at the end of January, and it's had a really big effect for us in terms of our e-news subscribers has gone through the roof, and a number of other things. And we're, for the first time, we're talking to our audiences. They're not just writing in visitor books. They're not just talking to the staff at the museum sites, all critically important, as well as our teacher feedback for the 50 plus thousand school children that come to our sites, but every single day we're getting impact on what's happening across our sites. Some good, some bad, some ugly, and how do we respond to how people are relating to us? So there's just a couple of examples of the home and architecture in particular. Some of our other digital engagement in and around other projects or programs, whether it's the forensic archive at Justice and Police Museum, actually gets more digital cut through than a lot of the home and architecture. But depending on the different sorts of audiences we're talking to, we get different types of engagement or kind of quicker uptake. And it's all about for us making that bigger entrance to museums. Obviously with 12, that's a bonus, but it's also a real challenge. We're not a single-sided institution like the Art Gallery or elsewhere. How do we, through all these different layers, kind of connect more and actually really kind of raise the awareness and the pleasure in visiting our different sites, whether it's online or in person? So I'm going to hand over to Julie to really talk about Home and Architecture, which, as I said, we launched in April this year. That's our magazine, the brochure that we went to 130,000 people through the Sydney Morning Herald. It's a very low-tech, old-fashioned type of marketing, but had a real reach for us. So how are we working across old technology, if you like, right through to digital engagement, and then our events guide. Okay.
I think we're running out of time, but I'll speed along. So, yes, Home and Architecture, as Caroline said, launched in April this year, and it really was the first opportunity for us to embed our brand and our brand position and philosophy across the whole organisation, from programmes to exhibitions, etc. And I'll show you that. This is quite a difficult slide to read, but really this is our home and architecture category. So it was created from within the organisation at looking at how do we bring our programmes, our exhibitions, our content and our properties together. And very much the architecture and the home is something that is core to our offer. So we see it across three or four exhibitions, Iconic Australian Houses and the Seidler exhibition bookend our year-long home and architecture programme. We have a variety of programmes. It cuts across our retail and merchandise with the likes of the Public Sydney publication. We're also working with our commercial leaseholds, food and beverage, restaurants, cafes, at how they can work with us in the home and architecture category. Of course, what were the objectives? It's those, if you like, that triple bottom line. How do we raise revenue and increase non-government funding through this program? How do we sell this program into corporate partners? Again, I think by creating the category, it has given us a greater offer to go to corporate partners with, and we have seen some really strong results there. We have secured and procured cash partners at a level that we haven't before, and also a number of cross-promotional and media partnerships. Our core segment that came out of our audience research is that average age 44, sort of evenly split male, female, and largely sort of north, east, and inner city based. But of course, for the secondary audience, for home and architecture, it is certainly those that have that interest, of course, in architecture, lifestyle design. So I'm just going to whiz through because I think we're down to a few minutes left and afternoon tea awaits. But we embarked upon a strong integrated cross-platform marketing campaign for home and architecture. And that, of course, sat across sort of own website. We have our e-news, our good old-fashioned quarterly event calendar, e-cards, databases, etc. This is some of our web design. I'm just going to flick through this. E-cards that we worked with our cross-promotional partners to instill into their databases, their networks. As Caroline mentioned, we produced the insert for the Sydney Morning Herald, which was 120,000 at launch of Home and Architecture. And Caroline's going to give a quick chat on the program.
So the invitation was obviously to come, and perhaps you hadn't visited for some time, but it was time to return, you know. And it was how we could mix up the kind of pictures of the very, very beautiful interiors, but connect them with different sorts of audiences. Because that's often our challenge, you know. A lot of our sites are very much, you know, they're elite white man houses, basically. How do we begin to break that down and start working within the communities to really kind of bring out the stories? And they're often, for each of those sites, multiple stories to the people who've lived there over the generations. Julie will talk a bit about hitting those targets, but we finished the last public program on Sunday for Iconic Australian Houses, which finished, and we've had fantastic, kind of quite lively discussions about preservation and conservation and protecting, and kind of how do we really work together as a community to save, salvage the kind of parts of our built environment that we need to going forward. Principally at the kind of centre of it was our own properties. So there was a lot of kind of layered programming that goes on top of this type of thing, but how could we actually bring out the stories of the sites more by looking at them from that home and architecture lens? You know, right through to Happy Birthday Susanna Place, which is 170 in a couple of weeks' time. For those of you who don't know, we manage the Caroline Simpson Library, which is the leading library on houses, interiors and gardens in Australia. We're still trying to get its awareness and its profile up. It's an extraordinary collection like no other. So Sophie's team did several programs that really kind of brought out the what exactly is in those collections. But we had people from Sheridan Sheets and a number of other type of areas showing different ways of using the collection like that. So in terms of measuring impact, obviously there's lots of different ways, as Jodie indicated. But of course for us it's about how we are core to mission and brand. Visitor numbers do matter. They matter increasingly. They are very much one part that government look to again and again. I've just spent the last day doing the cammed returns, Meredith Foley in the front row. We've had to answer Office of Environment and Heritage. No, pleasure to do it. Office of Environment and Heritage and a number of others. But we as arts institutions have to argue for different ways of measuring that impact as well. And it's incumbent on us to find other ways to do that as well as visitor numbers. Obviously, visitor experience, the physical experience of coming to the sites, what's it like? How do people, what are people making of their experience from the moment that they buy a ticket, or what's happening online from the decision to actually come to our sites, right through to the physical experience when they're here and beyond. Digital, obviously, it's a very easy way to measure your impact in what's the conversation, how many conversations are being had, and you're getting that direct feedback all day, every day from your audiences. Partnerships, Julie mentioned we've had a huge success with financial partnerships, but more than that, corporates really wanting to kind of connect with us because of their brand aligning obviously with our brand, and right through to the City of Sydney and other sorts of parts of government too working with us. Grants, obviously a big one, because it can allow you to do some of those difficult to do projects. Media coverage, very, very important with the marketing spend reducing. And then obviously the other sorts of more conventional things like reviews and awards and other ways of measuring. And so the results so far.
So yes, we're sort of 3-4 months into our year-long program and just looking at some of those results. So the Iconic Australian Houses exhibition is already at sort of 66% of our visitation targets. Our talks and tours associated series achieved 95% ticket sales. Our property nightlight tours, so that's a new tour that we've brought across our properties, are also seeing some strong results with 65%, whether they be at Elizabeth Farm or Marugal down in Nowra. A couple of our specialist tours also were sellouts. Media, we're still, of course, we have a long way still to go. We've achieved about 90, 90 articles across print, digital, broadcast and radio, and we are currently assessing the value of that media coverage. An example. Certainly in terms of our social and digital, we've seen some really strong results. So this is since we launched Home and Architecture in mid-April. Facebook's gone up by 10%, Instagram up 28%. Our e-news has increased by 58%, which is quite extraordinary. And actually in the year prior, it had doubled as well with the introduction of our brand. And we've been doing some online competitions to drive that subscriber database, which has been seeing some strong results. Year-on-year visitation has also grown, and that's just some examples there of across our properties, where particularly our house museums, which had seen some sort of plateauing in visitation, are seeing some really significant growth in their visitor numbers. We've talked a little bit about partnerships. So as I said, we've secured some new cash corporate partners for us that we actually look to take not only through the home and architecture category but onto other projects with us, and a number of exhibition and media and cross-promotional partners as well. But there's more to come. I don't know how much time we have, but Caroline will probably razzle through what we still have.
Okay, so 50s Fair this Sunday. If you haven't bought your tickets, there are a few if it would just stop raining. Thank goodness it wasn't last Sunday. So obviously that's a biggie for us. It's a small property in some ways, Rose Sidler House, and it gets more people on that one day, obviously, than it gets for the rest of the year. It is open to the public every Sunday, but a lot of people come because they want to dress up in their finery and join in the fashion parade. Sydney Open is our largest public program. We run it every 2 years, and this year we're hoping it will be the biggest yet on Sunday the 2nd of November, and it's where we extend ourselves right into the city and we open 50 plus buildings, and as well as obviously our own, and that's everything from undergrounds to bell towers to churches. Sometimes they're buildings that you are welcome to go into in part, but a lot of people don't until that day comes. We're just installing Dream Home Small Home, which is the antithesis to iconic Australian houses, which are, of course, houses for the 0.0001% among us, and certainly no one who works at Sydney Living Museums lives in them. This is Dream Home Small Home. It's very much about the owner builders in the post-war 50s and 60s, people camping in their caravans and building their own home, getting the plan from the department store catalogue or from the Women's Weekly. So a very different story to home ownership. And they're the plans, because you can't see it today. Harry Sidler's a big one for us. It opens on the 1st of November. You know, it's a new take on Harry for those people who are Sydney Siders, and it's very much about his artistic collaborations. And people say collaborator Harry, but in actual fact, he did incredible collaborations with artists like Alexander Calder, Frank Stella, Sola Witt, and a number. And we're really going to focus on those. So we're just working through some of the creative for that at the moment. And really how we can kind of diversify that audience way beyond the architecture and the design audience, just people who are interested in their own city and working through so that everything has a, works from the website through to the paper-based material. That might sound really straightforward, but in actual fact, we haven't always been in that position. Through to Penelope in front of the Kalara House. And part of that also is opening a number of buildings in the middle of, so in addition to Sydney Open, having a Sidler weekend where we're opening about 12 or 13. And then the big one, the kind of really intergenerational exhibition that will be here opening on December 13th is Towers of Tomorrow, a future look at... we're working with Ryan McNaught, he's one of the 12 certified Lego builders in the world, and he's building things like Taipei 101 and the Shanghai Tower, very much our kind of Asian, the context within which, Sydney Sydney lives, and there will be a handful of Sydney Towers, but the Eureka Tower in Melbourne and a range of others. So that's the kind of big summer exhibition. But instead of having the kids' play space adjacent to the main gallery, it's going to all be in one. So it's both display and you can engage and sit around all those green creative platforms. There will be stalls and you can make as you look. So there they are, the sort of extreme version. And part of the kind of way we measure too is how we can get them beyond, how we can get our exhibitions and programming obviously beyond city sites. So Australia Council and other types of funding bodies, we're endlessly applying for things, and happily the Australia Council has given us $82,000 to take that show that closed on Sunday right across Australia, so it can go into regional communities as well as other cities and be shared. And the great thing is it's also taking Karen with the exhibition, so it personalises it. These are some of the nightlight tours that are ongoing, and a number of the other sorts of programming that I haven't been able to show. And we're going to just show, we're doing a lot of film work, just quite cheaply made video with our kind of team of five in web and screen media, and they're always kind of looking at ways to really come and film staff doing different sorts of things and engaging with different audiences and turning them around very fast. And this is from the nightlight tour at Elizabeth Bay House a few weeks ago.
Gorgeous at night, and we're going to turn off as many lights as we can and invite people into the most intimate parts of the house, all by candlelight.
We'll be taking people through the house and they'll get a real feel for what it felt like, very different to what it is now, much darker, in some places much scarier.
We're going to look upstairs at the bedrooms, downstairs at some of the servant spaces, and of course in on the ground floor all of the sort of more formal spaces like the drawing room, the dining room, the breakfast room, which is really just the everyday living room, and of course the library, which was the centre of the house.
We're going to talk a little bit about some of the intimate sides of living at Elizabeth Bay House, looking at the servants and the kinds of trials and tribulations they went through, plus some of the private life stuff of Mr. and Mrs. McClay and their family. So a little bit more intimate here at night.
Thanks, Caroline and Julie. That was great. We're going to break now just for afternoon tea. Encourage you to join us in the foyer for a coffee or tea and a snack, and then we'll be back afterwards where we'll hear from Zoe Rodriguez from the Copyright Council. Thank you. to move on to our third presentation. And I'd like to welcome and introduce Zoe Rodriguez from the Copyright Agency. As a lawyer, and many other things, I'm sure, Zoe is passionate about the policies surrounding copyright and has advocated on behalf of the Copyright Agency's author, artist, and publisher members for the past 10 years. Since 2008, Zoe has channeled her energy into running of the Copyright Agency's Cultural Fund, which redistributes 1.5% of Copyright Agency's licensing revenue into the development of projects that will support the Australian publishing and visual arts industries. Zoe is going to talk about, from the point of view of the some of those projects, the acquittal processes, and of course the impact that she's looking for in those outcomes. So thanks, Zoe. Great to see you. I'll leave that.
You leave that for me. Oh goodness, gee, that's going at frenetic pace. A real pleasure to be here today, talking to you about the Cultural Fund. And Michael, I'll take on board your words to be politer. It's going to change the whole tenor of what I was going to say. I have not prepared a PowerPoint slide. I thought I would have a conversation about it, about the Cultural Fund. To give you a bit of context, we fund a diverse lot of things. We would fund around 150 projects and individuals per year to do a whole variety of things. We support things that will help individuals to develop their professional skills in publishing and visual arts. We will provide funding for industry-wide skills development through things like the Australian Society of Authors, the Australian Publishers Association, NAVA, and those sorts of organisations. We support prizes and programs that celebrate excellence, like the Miles Franklin Literary Award, like Victorian Indigenous Art Awards, all sorts of things. And we are particularly interested in helping to develop new markets for our members' works, whether that's visual arts or publishing, and whether that's in Australia or overseas. So they're the sort of variety of things we support, and we support the museums and galleries of New South Wales to run regional residencies across New South Wales. When our board makes allocations for funding, and it's a subcommittee of Copyright Agency's board that determines where funding goes, they will look at the objectives of a project and say, do they look like they're sort of closely aligned with our guidelines and our ambitions as set out in those guidelines on the website? And when it comes to acquittals, which is really reporting, the number one thing they will look at is, have you been working towards your objectives? Is that what you've achieved with the funding that we've given you? And we will look for all sorts of measurements that give us some idea of the reach of a project. So if it's a training program, how many people attended? If it's to support an exhibition, how many people saw it? If it's a website, well, how many people visit the site and seem to use it on a one-off basis or a regular basis? So we are interested in all those very tangible measures of things. But often the reasons that we support things are, I guess, what you would call heart reasons and gut instinct and things that we think are a good idea. So it might be promoting increased literacy levels in children from regional New South Wales. And I'm thinking about one particular project there where if you were looking for commercial outcomes, that certainly wasn't part of that project. But it was a really exciting, innovative project that had large social impact for that area. And that's now been built into something that is delivered not just in New South Wales, but across Australia. And then they have built connections with Indigenous communities in Canada and America. That sort of impact, how exactly do you measure literacy levels and engagement with community, and then engagement across borders with other people around the world. But they're the sorts of things that our board will look at. When they look at acquittals or reports or hear about how projects are going, there are a few things that will cause them great concern. If nobody turns up for something, they probably want to know why. They, on the other hand, things sometimes don't work well, and in acquittals, we don't. Our board doesn't just want a candy-coated report that says a whole lot of measurables that might look good on the surface, but if a thing didn't achieve objectives, they'd like to know why. And because our fund sees ourselves as a sort of guerrilla activity, maybe other funding bodies won't or haven't got onto yet, and yes, we see ourselves as catalyst for supporting innovative ideas. We don't mind hearing about it as long as best efforts have been made to succeed. We understand you take a risk, there's the risk that you don't succeed, there's a risk that you fail, but we like to know about it. So in those reports or acquittals, we like recipients of funding to talk to us, and probably not only at the formal write a report, submit an acquittal phase, but along the way, because sometimes we can partner in other ways to help make something that looks like it's not going to plan become successful. Now the other thing, when we are looking at some of those tangible, measurable outcomes, it's not just because we want recipients to have to spend time going through a form, clicking fields and filling out numbers. For us, one of the reasons to have reports on funding is for us to understand broader funding patterns for the Cultural Fund and to identify gaps in things that we're not funding enough, and then to say, we seem to have been doing a lot to support the promotion of visual arts and publishing in China. Look at that proportion of funding they've got. What's the impact been? Can we see increased sales of books? Do we see increased engagement between Chinese and Australian writers, and then more broadly between communities? So some of the purpose of those reports for us is not to look at numbers and berate anybody, or, you know, we'll certainly cheer if numbers look fantastic, but it's for us to be a bit more strategic about what we do in the future with funding. Now, I've lost my train of thought, which is why you should have PowerPoint or some sort of slide. So the economic impact for us, when we're looking at that, when I say we're interested in developing new markets for works and seeing sales of our members' works, that's because all of our cultural funding comes from members who are authors and publishers. Sometimes you can tell those economic results quickly, but often they will take years and years to crystallise. And sometimes you can't really claim them and say, oh, well, that cultural funding meant that 1,000 extra copies of that book sold. But other times people tell us, oh, this project that you supported 5 years ago, 6 years ago, we're fairly sure that's led to interest from this group and that group in a particular work. So you might have submitted your formal acquittal to copyright agency 5 years ago. Some of those returns don't come in till well later. We like people to stay in touch and tell us those things. And I think most recently the one of those that came about, and it was faster than many of those, was a person saying to me, or sending me an email saying, I got your creative individual's career funding to go to New York and work on a manuscript with a person who works in my particular area. You know, personally, I felt like that was a career-changing moment for me. And she said, but I just wanted you to know that I've been shortlisted for the Vogel Award. And I attribute part of that to your cultural funding helping me get to this particular place. We like to hear those stories. And for us, hearing those stories, one, it can tell us that we're on the right track or the wrong track, but also it helps us to promote the cultural fund. One of the purposes of acquittals and reports is so that we can share those stories of success and cultural activities with members and with the broader community to say, look, here's what the Cultural Fund's doing. And also to reassure our board, okay, we haven't gone completely crazy. There have been some extremely useful things that have been valued highly by people in the cultural communities. While I said, you know, I mentioned that there was a program in Western Sydney based on increasing literacy levels, the Cultural Fund, while we certainly want to see economic benefit for our members, I mean, authors are paid an average amount of $11,000 a year, and I'm talking about professional authors, so anything to increase that we want to be part of. But there are plenty of projects that we do for cultural benefit reasons, for that cultural impact. So one of the largest cultural fund allocations made to date is for a program called Reading Australia. And that is all about trying to get Australian stories loved, celebrated, taught in schools. And so for that, we will, you know, hopefully the books get sold, but the primary purpose is a cultural one and a community one for Copyright Agency. I think that's probably really all I can tell you about acquittals, except the couple of times we've got acquittals, and that it's really not often, where people have obviously only thought, all right, I'll just put down the metrics that say how many people attended a course, and I'll photocopy the receipts from what we spent the money on, and you really get no sense of actually what's happened with the project and what the real benefit or impact was for people who were there. And in those instances, we'll go back to a recipient and say, could you please provide us with more of a narrative around what happened so that our board can get a sense of the impact? And that's where numbers alone don't really tell a huge story. I think I'll leave it at that. Thank you very much for listening to me today, and I hope the other two presenters are interesting, and I'm so sorry that I won't be able to hang around for the Q&A session and for my two colleagues who will speak after me. Thank you.
Thanks, Zoe, and if my memory serves me correct, the Cultural Fund has two rounds per year. And you can have a look at all that information on the Copyright Agency's website.
Absolutely, and I'll let you know the brochure compliance.
Great, thank you, and have a good afternoon.
Thank you.
Now, it's a pleasure to introduce Rachel Healy from City of Sydney. Rachel has been working in the arts and cultural sector for more than 20 years, a career that includes 4 years as Director of Performing Arts for the Sydney Opera House, and 10 years as General Manager of Belvoir Street Theatre. She has held the role of Executive Manager, Culture for the City of Sydney since 2011, where she developed the draft City's new cultural policy and 10-year action plan. She's led the team that researched and launched the City's live music and performance action plan and the City's creative spaces initiatives on Oxford Street and William Street. And Rachel was telling me just before that the city is going to be adopting the cultural plan at the next meeting. So I'd like you to welcome Rachel to the podium. Thank you.
Thanks. Okay. There's a very oppressive stopwatch right next to me, designed to make me panic. So I'll try and I won't panic. Okay. Hang on. So, the City of Sydney, as you probably know, released a discussion paper and then a draft cultural policy entitled Creative City. The discussion paper was on public exhibition through March, April and May last year, And during that time, we undertook really extensive community consultation and engagement centred around the question, what kind of cultural life do you want for Sydney? The aim of the discussion paper was about provoking debate about the kind of creative life and cultural community we want. The city invests $34 million a year in cultural programs and services, but what most arts departments and government agencies won't tell you is that that money is predominantly going to the services, the festivals, the events and the programs that it was going to probably 50 years ago with incremental or small incremental changes. There's very rarely an opportunity to step back and say, look, we're doing all these great things that, you know, individually are worthy, but are they still really in sync with what the community want for their city? So it was one of those, once in a long time opportunities to check in that $34 million and that our priority areas were in fact what people expected and what people wanted for Sydney. So we conducted, we talked to members of the cultural sector about their aspirations. We mixed people up. We had architects sitting next to circus performers, who were sitting next to historians, who were sitting next to digital startup businesses. And we also talked to the public. We did road shows in the community. We talked to really everyone we could get our hands on, visitors to Sydney, residents of Sydney, about their aspirations. We talked to kids, as you can see, Crown Street Public School. And we also did an above-the-line marketing campaign where we invited people to go to the website and respond to the kind of provocations that we included there. For example, would your night last longer if the transport did too? Much of the discussion paper was formed from the consultation that we'd done previously for other initiatives. So the late night economy policy work, for example, asked people about what kind of nightlife they wanted in Sydney. And a huge amount of information came back through that process about the fact that, you know, I love going to the theatre or the cinema, but I'm quite anxious about getting the train at 10 o'clock, or there is no train at 10 o'clock, or there's only a train once every hour and a half, and it stops me going out. So we knew already that there was a whole lot of things that were going on that hadn't really found their way into a policy platform as a barrier to participation. Some more slides. This is a panel that we ran in Martin Place, which was kind of stupid but fun, where we asked, questions like karaoke or cabaret, nightclub or book club, and people would vote on their preferences. The responses were quite surprising. People were much more serious than we anticipated. We did a partnership with Avant-Garde and Urban Walkabout, inviting people to give us their views. You can see, I want small bars and art galleries open till 2 a.m. I want cultural experiences and festivals like dumpling making classes, hold a busking competition. Just so many responses, more than 500 postcards came in like this. We used social media channels and drove people to our consultation hub, which is Sydney Your Say. And we had overall a really fantastic response, and you can see some of the numbers there. Overall, just shy of 2,500 submissions or ideas. And so we took all of this information and this feedback, and we started to kind of see that the things people were telling us fell into six priority areas, which I'm going to talk through a bit today. And I want to speak about the priorities and how aspects of them directly or indirectly link to the museums or galleries sector. Because I think that there's, you can read in the whole document how sort of the general feedback and what that's meant for the City of Sydney's action plan, because our actions directly respond to the feedback we've got. But I think that there's particular learnings that have come out that feed into the work that you are doing. Probably the most popular issue that people wanted to talk about was precinct distinctiveness and creativity in the public domain. People want districts that have, or villages that have, a distinctive character and personality and that reflect the history and unique characteristics of their area. We know that Glebe is different to Oxford Street or King Street in Newtown is different to Pyrmont. But how legible is that? We know that because we've lived here, but certainly it's not always visible for a visitor, and it's not necessarily always obvious in the street, the history of the area in particular. Aligned with this is a call for more visible evidence of creativity in the public domain. This means that cultural institutions need to think seriously not only about the activities that go on within their four walls, but explore opportunities to connect with their neighbours so a visitor might have reason to stay longer in the precinct than originally planned. For example, we know that most of the state cultural institutions in Sydney are planning capital projects. The Art Gallery of New South Wales, the Australian Museum, Sydney State Library, the Opera House, Pier 23 at Walsh Bay, Barangaroo, Powerhouse Museum. Given that, what are the opportunities in that capital planning to think about what's happening outside the four walls? Botanic Gardens, another one, obviously. And so how can we ensure not just the practical things? Well, if we're all developing capital plans, who's looking after Wi-Fi in the public domain? Who is looking after wayfinding and signage? What's the visitor experience going to be coming into this area? Opera House, which is kind of only a stone's throw from the State Library, gets only 10% of the visitors, and yet they're so close. Why can't there be better connectivity in our thinking about what our institutions are doing that then delivers dividends for the visitors who come and visit that geographic area? It's also an opportunity for small-scale, temporary, interstitial activity that might occur around the physical institution and for consideration of the partnerships that can encourage this. The phrases that were used very frequently on the postcards and in the feedback were things like spontaneous, hidden, unusual. This is what people said they wanted for Sydney. One quote reads, "I want to be regularly surprised in a city that is so familiar. Unique events in unlikely places, bands in train carriages, rooftop cinemas, nights where museums stay open until 2 a.m, bars in underground tunnels, permanent table tennis tables in the park." These are the kinds of, this is the kind of feedback that people said would help them re-engage with the cultural offer of this city. There was also a strong interest in seeing the history, people and stories of our city built into the public domain. This could include the stories of the buildings and streets told in more creative ways than traditional approaches. And another quote from our feedback. "We would like to propose a new vision for the way history can be communicated and to engage varied audiences, collaborating with different art forms and embracing digital technologies." There are places in the UK that have celebrated the history of the area in unconventional ways. So for instance, in the birthplace in Morecambe, England, where Eric Morecambe was born, instead of a sort of a typical plaque, they've etched the punchlines for all his most famous jokes into the pavements of the city, and finding creative ways of sharing information about a place other than traditional ways is something that came up frequently. Considered together, it kind of means looking at the unexpected urban surfaces to share knowledge in the floor plate, in the bathrooms, on the roof, or in this case, as you can see, in the trees. This is an example of a partnership that the City of Sydney did with the Australian Museum in Hyde Park, which is of course immediately adjacent to the gallery, to the museum. The work is called Emergence by Craig Walsh, and it's a three-channel digital video projection with stereo sound on the existing landscape. The installation continues a series of ephemeral artworks which focus on elements of local history that have been edited or, in the artist's words, denied representation in public space. He says, "Defining what is important to record for historical purposes and immortalised in public monuments has often been in the hands of those with selective motivations. Emergence pays homage to Hyde Park's history as a meeting point for civic unrest, protest and direct action." Three individuals from diverse backgrounds, Colin Charlton, Jennifer Ann Curtis and Sylvia Hale, are linked through their commitment to social change movements, and their faces are presented as a collective monument to civic action. So it was a way of telling the story of three protesters from Sydney's history in the trees of Hyde Park. The second priority is about new avenues for creative participation. And the focus of this priority area, I guess, is around the fact that people's engagement with culture and creativity is significantly changing. And what I mean by that is 10 years ago, people's, I guess, main way of participating was through spectatorship, going to see a band or going to the theatre or to a movie or whatever. In the last 10 or 12 years, the Australian Bureau of Statistics has been measuring what can only be described as a seismic change in the way people are engaging, and that's around participation. People are making and doing in greater numbers than ever before. Jewellery making has increased in the last 10 years by 600%. Digital photography, metalworking, learning handcrafts in some way. I mean, you can see it in evidence of things like Frankie magazine, which is now an incredibly popular and growing magazine on our news agency shelves. But behind that is this incredible interest in actually participating. And part of that is the digital technologies. We know that platforms like Etsy mean that, you know, you might have previously made jewellery and given them to friends and family at Christmas time. Now that jewellery can be sold through a little Etsy shop worldwide. 70% of the sales that Australian Etsy sellers are making are to international buyers. And so we're seeing a blurring, I think, between the old idea of amateur and professional. And this invites kind of interesting questions, I think, about the sort of services that a city government provides in order to support that change in the way people are engaging. But I guess I wanted to talk also about different kinds of participation in a museum and gallery context. The image on the right is a work from Titian, which is part of a triptych. And in 2012, the National Gallery in London wanted to find a way of celebrating their recent purchase of one of three Titians in this series for the gallery. The three, depicting the myth of Diana and Actaeon, were going to hang together for the first time since the 18th century. So the National Gallery is sort of the home of rarefied old masters and a temple to long dead artists. But they asked three local artists, Mark Wallinger, Chris Ophili, and Conrad Shawcross, to develop new works in response to the triptych and the hanging of these pieces by Titian. So Wallinger developed an installation which took as its defining image the moment depicted in Titian's work here, where the hunter Actaeon accidentally stumbles across Diana in the bath. And if you know the Greek myth, she is furious about this, that he has turned up and has spied her and her maids washing, and she turns him into a stag, whereupon his own hunting dogs rip him to shreds. It's very grim. But Wallinger's response was to create a temporary structure where visitors to the gallery enter into this world, and the Guardian described it thus: "The room is in complete darkness. As you fumble your way around, eventually you become aware that at the centre of the space is a room within a room, a second structure. You feel your way around it, and finally you find a window. The glass is opaque, but a corner of it is broken, and you place your eye against it. You can see into a bathroom. Draped in an armchair, or soaping herself in the bath, or cleaning her face at the mirror, is a naked woman caught in a live act. As you move around outside of the room, you find other apertures. You stoop down to look through a keyhole or peer through a chink in a Venetian blind. It is an utterly strange experience that turns the visitor into a voyeur, a peeping Tom." "The myth of Diana and Actaeon is the ultimate fable about voyeurism," said Wallinger. "There is an extraordinary savagery with which Actaeon is dispatched and given a deadly metamorphosis. My purpose was to make that contemporary in the context of Titian and the National Gallery. The building, after all, is all about the history of the male gaze and the female nude." And in order to get volunteers, they did a call out through Twitter. You had to genuinely be called Diana in order to participate. And they had a fantastic response. And so six of these models on a roster basis went into this cubicle and undressed and bathed. So the visitors to the Titian could find a new way of experiencing what, in fact, the painter was trying to reveal. It was such a memorable way of announcing what would otherwise seem like a worthy but probably a pretty dry purchase by the gallery. And I think it's a great example of really what people are talking about when they talk about a participatory experience, that people are really creative about what that might mean and how it might make the material that they have, which otherwise might look a bit dry, how that material can be reimagined and re-energised to engage people. The third priority is sector sustainability, and it concerns, obviously, how our cultural sector and not-for-profit arts organisations are sustainable. Cultural institutions are often expert at making their case to government for funding, and many are getting much better at driving earned revenue from philanthropic and sponsorship sources. But there seems to be less emphasis on entrepreneurial thinking and understanding how some of the assets that cultural institutions have can be used to drive new income and new audiences. The large performing arts institutions like Sydney Opera House probably do it best. They sometimes use variable pricing models, which means the price you pay for your ticket might be different to the amount your neighbour paid, much like an airline. This means that as demand changes and exhibitions are often most popular in their final days, the organisation has the flexibility and setup to increase the ticket prices to maximise yield. It's based around demand. They also are active in managing the proximity to the stage through pricing reserves. A lot of work goes into audience segmentation, understanding pricing sensitivities in each audience segment, and what each audience segment values and would pay extra for. A dad with two kids under five might expect the museum trip to be free, but is happy to pay a reasonable amount for an interactive workshop followed by a kids' meal at the cafe. Two seniors might also expect the general collection to be free, but will pay a significant sum for a unique and exclusive access to rare material not usually on display, with a talk by one of the scientists or curators. Experimenting with new ways of sweating the assets and putting rigorous research rather than thought bubbles into the right price points is something the city is keen to support in its policy priorities. It's particularly easy to see the opportunity in Sydney when there is always such a craving for the new and unique and different. The above image is obviously from Jurassic Lounge, which targeted 20-somethings to come to the Australian Museum as an after-work bar. But reinvention is key. After a while, Sydney's audiences will move on to the next thing, so refreshing the idea is essential. Understanding the needs of current and potential audiences means an organisation puts the audience at the centre of their plan and understands what other trends are hitting Sydney and New South Wales, which might hold opportunities for cultural institutions. This idea extends not only to unexpected non-traditional experiences, but also timeframes, late night offerings for people in their 20s, as well as early morning offerings for parents with kids, for example. Priority four is about improving access and creating markets. These are the issues that people told us were stopping them from participating with greater regularity than they would like to. Barriers are around affordability, information and promotion, and that means not feeling like there's aggregated information about how to engage with what's on offer in Sydney. Transport, perennially transport, childcare, performance times and opening hours, access for people with disability and a lack of information about that, and education and young people, that there wasn't enough information or exposure when they were young that's driven an interest when they were older. The city's got a range of actions to respond to this, but one of the actions is around trialing use of our childcare facilities so they are available in the evenings for people to use up until, say, 9 p.m. And the principle is that if you can drop your children, school-aged, into an accredited facility, then you're going to really take away the cost of babysitting, which is incredibly expensive. You know, it's usually $100 a night. So if you can make a centre that's already set up, it already has staff, it's already in operation from 9 to 6, if you can extend its opening hours and say to the people who might like to go to a museum or see a show after work, if you make that space available, can that help take away just one of those barriers that's preventing more active participation? That in light of that, cultural organisations in a particular precinct could work together to offer coordinated nighttime offerings, as occurs in other cities. One quote from the feedback. There is an art initiative in London which I think is great and would be a great benefit to Sydney. It's called First Thursdays. All of the galleries in the Shoreditch Triangle have late night viewings, usually coinciding with a change of exhibition on the first Thursday of the month. What I love is that you get to go to many galleries in one night and get to socialise and meet other artists, designers or art enthusiasts, as well as going to galleries that may not be on your radar. So there's a social experience as well as an opportunity to walk within a precinct and see what's on offer. And that obviously has links to the theme of precinct distinctiveness as well. The fifth priority is around sharing knowledge. And this is linked obviously to our priority around public participation and the community as co-collaborators, and that optimises opportunities for crowdsourcing and public voting as platforms for engagement. Obviously, this image is from the O at Mona, and I'm sure I don't need to talk to this audience about the questions Mona raises for museums and galleries. But I raise it because the experiences there are directly linked to some of the public feedback we received in the cultural policy formulation process. In particular, how information is shared is really important. Some commentators believe part of Mona's popularity is the approach to authorship. Rather than there being a single narrative with no authorship attributed, like tablets that have come from on high, the descriptions of the works have a range of authors. In some cases, the responses are quite critical. The Guardian notes that people have responded to Walsh's rebuttal of what a gallery should do. Quoting David Walsh, essentially before you enter the door, you're told what to think. We are judges of all that is good and great. Grovel and be humble in front of our power. So how do you subvert that and be democratic? The idea is to give no cues at all about what to expect. He's being a little disingenuous because while there are no cues about what to expect, there are many, sometimes opposing ways visitors are encouraged to think about the artwork. There's a whole range of offerings on the digital device that talks about the artwork and all kinds of ways into it. And despite the focus on technology, it's more about their approach to sharing knowledge that seems so broad-minded. A friend's sister who was a nurse in a poor area in north of Tasmania said it was the only museum she's ever been to where she didn't feel dumb. And I think that that comment perfectly summarises one of the challenges that guardians of information face. This has been really instructive as well in thinking about the city's history unit, which we have a city historian and a team, which traditionally has focused on generating content. It's published really fantastic histories of Redfern and Waterloo, for example. But through this process, it's become really clear that we need to move away from only providing content and more about thinking about how that content is made really accessible to people who don't know that they're interested in it. The sixth priority is around global engagement. Opportunities to build international connections means both thinking about supporting our local artists and companies reach global markets, but also opportunities to enhance and support cultural tourism. Many people saw obvious ways we could connect visitors with the cultural attributes of the city and broader New South Wales. There was a discussion about the creation of a cultural priority pass, which provided special access to a range of cultural institutions across New South Wales. We also received feedback that Sydney wasn't strategic in terms of building relationships with international artists and thought leaders, and we don't always plan to extract full value from visitors to Sydney through masterclasses or public forums like this one or networking events. So we've come up with a series of actions to respond to this. How are we going? Oh, it's locked. So I don't know if I've gone over or under. Okay, that's it from me. 2 minutes. Okay. Obviously, I haven't spoken a great deal about measurement and evaluation in this. We have a whole range of ways in which we're going to measure the success of our plans. But also, I guess it's worth me commenting that as a funding body, we're also kind of shifting, I guess, into the way that we are evaluating the success of the programs we support. I'm also on the Major Performing Arts panel of the Australia Council, and so I think that there's a shift nationally as well as at a city government level. When we talk about, great experiences for everyone, I think that my experience is that there hasn't always been a great deal of rigour around what that means, particularly nationally. Do we ask funded organisations to do postcode analysis of who their audiences are? Are we rigorous about asking organisations to give us detail about the visitor experience? What about research around the people who aren't coming? When I was in Tasmania, I did the usual sort of cabbie hairdresser audit and said to all of those cabbies and hairdressers that I came in contact with, have you been to Mona? What do you think? And every single one of them said, I've been a few times, I love it, it's fantastic. Now, when I've applied the same principle in Sydney, I can tell you, almost every cab driver I've spoken to doesn't go to museums in Sydney. You say, what about the MCA? No. What about the art gallery? No. And I think that while it's important that we evaluate the success of the programs we're running and measure attendances, and that's all incredibly important. But at some point, I think as a sector, we need to probably be more mature about really understanding why people aren't coming and working harder to incentivise that kind of engagement. That's all. Thank you.
Thanks, Rachel. I recall when I was running the regional gallery in Tamworth, we invited all the cabbies around for a beer just so they knew where the place was. Yeah. I'd like to welcome Zanny Begg to the stage. Zanny works as an artist, a writer and an organiser. She was previously the director of Tin Sheds Gallery and is currently employed as an academic at the College of Fine Arts, University of New South Wales. Her recent exhibitions include The List, Campbelltown Arts Centre and Things Fall Apart at Artspace in Sydney. Zanny has also participated in the Istanbul Biennial, Taipei Biennial and the Sharjah Biennale and undertaken residencies in Hong Kong, Indonesia, Chicago and Barcelona. Ladies and gentlemen, Zanny Begg.
Okay. Great. Hi, it's good to be here. All right, today I guess I want to discuss the notion of where art might end and where politics might begin. And the vexed nature of that. I put these quotes up here to begin this presentation as I think they highlight just how complicated this question is. While we may feel we know this terrain, in recent months there's been various instances that have refocused our attention on how art and the social might fit together. I want to return to this issue that's raised in these quotes here in a little bit, but first I actually just want to talk about a personal experience of involvement in an exhibition that I thought might shed some light, I guess, on some of these discussions. For 4 months, from March to August this year, I entered the secretive world of a maximum security prison for children in Sydney's western suburbs. My passport into this highly restrictive world was an artist residency organised by Campbelltown Arts Centre. Rebe Juvenile Detention Centre caters for kids between 10 and 18 years of age, at high risk and on long-term sentences. After discussions with the education unit, I was allocated a group of about 20 14-year-old boys to work with, seven of whom chose to work with me. Through the residency, I hope to challenge the institutional disempowerment these young men face. In our first project, Rooms, the boys curated their own living environment by producing a series of oversized drawings to wallpaper the small grey and beige boxes that they spent most of their days in. This was a long and complex process. The images had to pass several levels of bureaucracy. For example, you weren't allowed any references to Tupac, I discovered, because that might promote gangster culture. But once we jumped all those hurdles, we finally managed to install them. These boys, you have to remember, are not allowed on the internet, let alone on social media sites that a lot of teenage culture is predicated on. So researching and developing ideas was quite difficult. Strangely, for someone my age, we met halfway. Their several years out of date idea of youth culture kind of met my fading connection with the world of teens. Tupac was quite a meeting point. Unfortunately, we weren't allowed to use him, but I felt, hey, I'm hip. They're really into him, and I remember listening to Tupac, or I still do. The day of the installation was a minor victory, with the boys hanging out in each other's rooms, which is something that they never really get to do, and working together to wallpaper images on each other's walls. So just to show you a little bit about that, this is the room beforehand, and this is it afterwards. This is one of the rooms beforehand, and this is one of the rooms afterwards. So you can see it's quite a transformation. And this was a very particular audience in a particular event. These boys were really curating something for themselves because they can't share their rooms with anyone else. Our next project was working on a collaborative video project called Doing Time. The video was shot inside the courtyard of the detention centre and is an exploration of the experience of time through the eyes of four young people who are prematurely forced to confront its gravity. It struck me when I spoke to these boys, in some ways they talk like old men. We let the time pass. They spent a lot of time just letting time pass. One of the challenges that in this project is that we're not able to show the boys' faces for their own sake, I guess, because when they come out, they want to have a fresh start. So a key part of the film was developing costumes that shielded the boys' identities at the same time as revealing things that were important to them. Through a series of drawing workshops, together we created logos that incorporated things that they wanted to share with an outside public, things they felt that could act as some sort of shield for their identity, including, as you can see here, the Aboriginal flag, logos for brands. My God, they were so into brands, which was challenging for me because, you know, I'm sort of really, you know, no logo, and here they were. It's like Adidas, it's got to be Ralph Lauren, it's got to be Versace, you know, the bigger the better, really, drawings and so forth. These shields were then transformed into jackets that were costumes for the film. So you can see these here. And again, the branding was so important. Like, it was the colour, it was the brand. And I spent weeks getting it exactly right. And, you know, we couldn't go online and we couldn't shop together. So it was quite a risky thing for me to go out and buy these jackets and bring them in. And I have to say, it was so exciting when they saw them. It was like, you know, Christmas hit the jackpot. They got the colour, the brand, and their logo on it as they wanted. Here's another image. And I think, yeah, that's it for those. So the film had its first screening inside the jail on the 22nd, and then the release again was quite complicated because, like, you weren't allowed two-pack, you weren't allowed masks, even though we had to have masks because we couldn't show the boys' identity, but then again you weren't allowed them because that might promote gangster culture, so it was quite complicated, but eventually it was agreed and released, and then it was shown publicly at The List, which is an exhibition that's currently on at Campbelltown Arts Centre, curated by Megan Monty. So these are images of the film, stills from the film. So how does this project relate to the issues that I began this talk with? For me, being involved in an exhibition such as The List opens up possibilities for ways of thinking about how art and politics fit together. The List was curated as the Campbelltown Arts Centre realised that Campbelltown had a very young population, around 20% were under 18, and it wanted to commission a group of artists to produce a series of new works that might engage these young people in the gallery. So the other artists involved, aside from myself, were the Abdullah brothers, Kate Blackmore, Marvin Gaye Chetwin, Sean Gladwell, Michaela Gleave, Hahan, Robert Hungerford, Pilar, Daniel Kuhn, Tom Polo, and George Tillanakis. So a group of international, local, well-known and emerging artists. For my particular project, it was difficult to engage the boys in the gallery for obvious reasons. So we realised early on that the project would need to have multiple audiences, those inside and those outside jail. For the boys inside, they were my first and toughest audience for the project. And for those outside, I can only hope that it might help people imagine what life was like for these boys and might allow the gallery to reach, I guess, other marginalised kids who maybe are not in jail but around that milieu or have friends who are and so forth. So the first thing I can say about social engagement and impact is that it helps if galleries think about multiple audiences that they might attract, and that many reach that. This is a project of us working together to storyboard the film. So now to talk about some of the issues for this project. Before entering the jail, I knew that Aboriginal kids would be overrepresented in the young people that I met inside. We probably know the statistics, but according to the Australian Institute of Health and Welfare, the national rate of juvenile incarceration for Aboriginal people is 31 times higher than non-Indigenous young people. And according to recent figures released by Patrick Gibson from the senior researcher at the Jabana House of Learning at UTS, more Aboriginal children are being institutionalised and taken off their families than during the era when this was official government policy through the Stolen Generation. So it's actually a really huge issue. It was devastating once inside jail to hear from the assistant principal that 100% of the kids were Indigenous. All the boys that I work with are Aboriginal, with the one exception being a boy from the South Pacific Islands. As a non-Indigenous woman, I was very cautious about working with a bunch of teenage boys who were from Indigenous backgrounds. I understand that self-determination is crucial, and I knew I couldn't really address or speak to much of the cultural issues they were experiencing, and clearly you can see through the symbols they chose for themselves that they really wanted to talk about. But on the other hand, I respected that these boys had chosen to work with me, and I aimed to do the best I could by them to create an interesting collaborative framework for the project. And also, now that it's finished, I hope to use opportunities like this to raise awareness about the reality of what is going on in our prison system. Most of these boys describe jail as a stabilising factor in their lives, somewhere that, where they actually got to go to school, be fed, have a place to sleep. Yet all were emphatic, you do not want to be here. It was a place of loneliness, isolation, crushing boredom and fear. As one boy explained, you always have to watch your back in here. For the 4 months I spent inside, it showed me that these kids are growing up without access to the outside world, things like the internet that we take for granted, their families and their freedom. And I can only imagine the consequences of this will be as dire as those for the Stolen Generation. So how does this link back to the quotes I started with? Just to bring you a little bit back, I don't know how much time I've got, but as you can probably tell, one of these quotes is from Luca Bjornanetis about the withdrawal of works over the Biennale of Sydney, which, just to refresh people's memories or if people hadn't heard about it, was over Transfield, the company that took over the contract for mandatory detention in Manus Island and Nauru, and who were the founding sponsors of the Biennale of Sydney. And the other is from Casper Coing over the boycott of Manifesto 10, which Manifesto being a major European Biennale, which was held in Russia, and artists were protesting over Russia's anti-gay laws and also the aggression in the Crimea. These two men, who had both been the subject to a boycott, were brought together in an uncomfortable dialogue by Sonia Hornig for their arguments that they put forward around what happened in their particular experience. So where does art end and politics begin? Since March this year, we've seen three major withdrawals from international exhibitions by artists who were dissatisfied with the ethical arrangements of the institutions and or sponsors. The Biennale of Sydney, the Manifesto 10 Russia, and also Living as Form touring exhibition in Israel. Without dwelling too much on these cases, I think we're seeing a shift, perhaps like the seismic shift that Rachel mentioned in her presentation, in cultural production from representation of social issues, such as we see Luca Bjornanetis urging here, into an engagement with them. Just as we've witnessed a sweeping expansion of bespoke, DIY, green and sustainable lifestyle choices that in the past might have been dismissed as hippie or lifestyleless and so forth, I think we're seeing a concomitant shift in culture as artists and curators start to ask questions about their own personal responsibilities within the production of art. Who's funding it? Who's it for? What's the audience? Who gets to engage? Who doesn't? These kind of questions I think all of us are asking, and our audiences are asking them as well. I think audiences are beginning to tire of the specularisation of otherness and are seeking more meaningful and engaged ways of connecting art and the social sphere. My last slide that I want to show with you today is from Ahmet Ogut's achingly appropriate contribution to the most recent Biennale of Sydney, Stones to Throw, that people may have seen out in Cockatoo Island. As most of you probably know, Ahmet was one of the artists acting, as Luca Bjornanetis might say, in poor taste, who withdrew his works from the Biennale of Sydney, only returning them once. And actually, just on that, it wasn't that he was the problem at all. The problem was that Transfield was involved in mandatory detention. That was the problem. And those of us who are involved in this campaign were very clear that we'd prefer that Transfield actually stayed as a sponsor of the Biennale but actually withdrew from Manus Island and Nauru. But given that didn't happen, it was unsustainable, in our opinion, that they continue to fund a cultural event which, whilst they were involved in this kind of activity. So while this is an older work that Ahmet had made that was prepared prior to the Biennale, it came to powerfully evoke the complexities of the debates that were later to emerge. When I look at this image, I immediately think of the old adage, people in glass houses shouldn't throw stones. It can be complicated to mix art and politics, and it can be uncomfortable to address our own weaknesses and complicity. We can see how uncomfortable the Biennale Transfield debate made many in the art world with the toxicity of some of the responses and debates. It got really heated, it got really personal, it got really difficult very quickly. But with the benefit of distance, I think the issue is not to throw stones, it's not to cast blame, but to try and find ways we can open a dialogue and shift cultural production in more engaged and sustainable ways, so that I guess the content about which we might be making work gels with the structures that support the exhibition of that work. And that means bringing exhibitions into line with social and environmental concerns that many of the artists commissioned to make works feel and are at the centre of their practice. But of course, I'm kind of twisting Ahmet's work because it was intended in a completely different way than I've just mentioned. The work is not about glass houses or he who has not sinned throw the first stone or any sort of biblical analogies. It is actually about another biblical analogy, which is David and Goliath. This is a project where he actually custom made these stones, which were sent to kids in Kurdistan to throw at the occupying Turkish forces. Ahmet created these stones and posted them to the kids who used them in their struggle against the troops that police their everyday life. Now, we may think that conflicts such as these are a world away from us here in Australia, but when I read about this project, I could not help thinking about the boys who I worked with and their struggles against the legacy of colonial occupation right here in Sydney. And I actually just wanted to end. I've got no idea how much time I've taken because I speak really fast, so maybe under, maybe over, I'm not sure. But I wanted to end with a quote, which was from one of those boys, that in some ways throws into relief the experience that I had with the boys in Western Sydney. And he says, it's a story about meeting him. I asked his name. He didn't want to tell it. I asked why. He said, "We are released by law amendments as we are under 18 years of age. However, they begin to put us in jail when we're older than 18. That's why I do not want to tell you my name." I asked, "Would you like to pick a nickname for yourself?" And he said, "Let's try Umut, hope. We wouldn't be able to live without hope. That's why I prefer you call me Umut." Thank you.
Thanks, Annie. We've got some time now for some questions, and the speakers would like to come forward and sit down. We've got some microphones, and if you have a question, put your hand up. If you could wait until you get the microphone, because we are recording, as pointed out, and if the speakers could use the microphones in reply too. So are there any questions? Now, I know that this often takes few minutes to warm up, a few seconds. There's one.
Hi everyone, Bridget Uren from Maitland Regional Art Gallery. I'm delighted to be here. Thank you, Museum of Sydney and MG. I don't really have a question, it's just an offering. I don't know if anybody subscribes to Museum 2.0, that they had a and library or something, and it was just worth reading based on how to measure what the impact is socially.
I got a question for Rachel. What provision is there in the cultural plan for letting things happen that haven't been thought of, that, you know, that aren't considered now, you know?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. A whole lot of time internally went into the discussion about the dangers, I think, of government intervention and top-down initiatives to try and kind of fix things. Not just fix things. You know, City of Sydney produces festivals. It's very active, and that's great, but you don't change a city by government, you know, doing a Chinese New Year, as wonderful as that is, or an Art and About. You change cities by ensuring that you've got enabling capability that that ensures that anyone can start something and grow it. And so we talk really specifically in the policy section about the fact that we are going to start to better balance the sort of top-down services with our enabling function, which means that there's somebody on the end of a phone who can help you when, you know, you've been presented with a 90-page DA document that you need to fill out if you were trying to activate a laneway or trying to do a documentary film festival in a laneway, and you have to fill out a document that was designed for the person who's building a block of flats. You know, that there is so much, not just red tape, but so much process that hasn't been designed to accommodate people who are just trying to try something new, to think of an idea and have a go, that we need to spend, or government, but the City of Sydney obviously needs to spend time and staff and resources in making it a whole lot easier. There's a series of actions that are that look internally focused, but that are about building our capability in ensuring that people can do things for themselves rather than the city simply coming up with a new festival or whatever.
Okay, thanks. Anyone else?
Thank you. Sabina Peritore, Sydney Living Museums. I was fascinated by Rachel's vox pops with hairdressers and cab drivers and the different responses between the ones in Tasmania and in Sydney. And the essential question, how to get into a museum, people who have never put their feet inside a museum. And Zaghi's experience and art project was unbelievable in this. I'm very impressed by you being able not only to work with people who are completely isolated from society, but you basically made them enter the museum in this indirect way and made them protagonists of what's happening in the museum. And that, I think that's unbelievable. So I just wanted to extend the question to everyone. How do we get these people who've never been inside our galleries and museums and homes, how do we engage them? What can we do about it? Thank you.
I might leave the comments to the more sensible museum people around me. But one of the things that David Walsh says is we don't spend any money on marketing, we just try and have really good ideas. And I think that there's something in that, that it's about thinking of ways that are engaging, that might engage. And I guess I should preface it by saying it means taking a risk and it means trying things that are new, as well as understanding what the barriers are to people's engagement. And that's all the kind of really boring stuff, like the transport isn't there, or I think I'll be bored, I've got no interest, I've got, you know, childcare challenges, all of the kind of things that we know stop people who are interested, let alone those who think that wouldn't be a place for me, I'd feel dumb or I'd be bored. So I think that, you know, there's a raft of solutions to those things, but coming up with an idea that sounds fun is a really good, like the example I gave from London, that just sounds like an interesting thing to do, I think is part of it.
I think the other factor with Mona is that it's free for locals. So although most museums and galleries are free, when looking at Tasmania and Hobart specifically, it's more the symbolic power of that, that it's free for locals, but tourists have to pay. That when I also regularly do the taxi check, actually Michael and I did that on our way here, didn't we? And yes, the taxi driver had not been in because he thought it would take a whole day to come. But with Mona, talking to the taxi drivers and stuff, that sense of ownership, that this is our gallery, this is our museum, and you tourists value it so much you're willing to come and pay. So I think there's a lot of signalling that Mona has done quite subtly to create that sense of community ownership of the museum. And that then enables people to feel that they can come and take a risk there. And I think also O has been instrumental in that, that there's no value judgment on your opinion, but you're at least asked your opinion. And it's interesting to then know how many other people disliked it or liked it. It's just a human quality to their programming that I think really excels, and that's what so many around the world are now benchmarking on. So good for Australia that they're benchmarking on a museum in Tassie. Yeah.
I think it's ironic though that Mona, which I actually have to admit I haven't seen yet, but I will, but it's actually a private museum and people feel more ownership of it than a public museum, and that's something for us to consider.
I don't know that people care, whether it's public or private, really. And although I think it is really interesting because you'd think that the experience of Sydney Opera House would have taught Australians that cities can be completely reborn on the back of inspiring ideas like Sydney Opera House or like Mona, extraordinary visions of an individual that can transform a city and a sense of, you know, identity and social confidence. And yet we haven't, as Australians, taken the learnings of the Opera House at all to heart, because there's no way it would be, with the kind of government attitude that there, you know, we're, as a government, we're about risk elimination, not risk management. There's no way that a Mona could be built as a government project, I think, at the moment. The completely new conceptualising of what a museum can be. And that's, I think, the tragedy, is that governments now... it's almost unthinkable that something like that could come out as a government initiative.
I agree with that. I mean, I think the other point, Rachel, you made is that, you know, we have all the single public institutions and we are one of them. We may have 12, we may not have one, but how do we break it down that we're all working collectively? I mean, it's a very, very good point, because I think we are often in quite austere, quite confronting buildings. They may have banners and other sorts of things out the front, but a lot of them were built 100 years ago plus. And how do we kind of break that down, and what's the explicit invitation that we need to make? We can't just wait, and through the kind of, you know, the marketing tools that we may or may not have, people still have to want to search you out to come to you. So how do we do that through, you know, working with other sorts of institutions, whether it's the example that you've given, Zanny, or any others that kind of can break that down? Because I think the problem is often institutions don't know necessarily fantastic staff, but where to go to, because often, you know, they're full of like-minded people too, individual museums, that, you know, there's a reason people want to come and work in those institutions, because, you know, they've gone to university and they like working in kind of creative hubs, so they're actually not exposed to taxi drivers and all the other sorts of people who perhaps aren't part of that club. And how do we actually begin to break that down through the types of staffing models that we have, and a much more, you know, that impact that you had, I think, in your first table of, it, you know, it starts with your staffing and other sorts of, you know, to really kind of change that model of what major cultural institutions are.
Just to add one more observation. In my taxi driver polls, I find most do have university degrees, but they're often from overseas, and they're not recognised here in Australia. Yeah. So there's barriers of, you know, racism, cultural barriers that might keep them away from museums that we also need to confront.
And I think the university system, in some ways, that thing of kind of going to university for the first time or going to museums for the first time, what is that kind of threshold that you need to go beyond? And I think some of the universities are doing a lot of that type of work quite well, and that there's actually quite a lot that we can learn from the types of active partnerships, major financial partnerships that are actually allowing much greater kind of social inclusion programs and other sorts of things. Well, I don't, the museums are doing it in individual programs, and we do them through individual programs, but it's how you can actually make that far more integrated.
There's one more question up.
Thank you, Anne MacArthur from the Art Gallery of New South Wales. Great, thought-provoking talks from everyone. Thanks very much. I have a lot of questions, but maybe to continue the discussion, maybe from anybody, just what would be your pick of branding all our Sydney institutions? I have this walking to work from Wynyard to Martin Place. A tourist stopped me with her map, and she said, "Where's this?" "The Australian Museum. I want to go on my first day in Sydney and learn about Australian history. And this is the Australian Museum. It's the National Museum." And I said, I'm not sure you'll get that. And she says, "Oh, I'm also going over here, the Rocks, because I love contemporary art." And I said, "Yeah, you'll get that there, but I have a vested interest here." I said, "Where are you from?" "China." "So come with me and you can get some history and contemporary art and learn about, you know, Australia through the art." But she hadn't... the Art Gallery of New South Wales wasn't on her map at all, you know. So I just wonder, maybe feedback from Rachel, in your ideal world, how would you rebrand the Sydney galleries?
look, it's such an interesting story you've told. I think, I don't know about rebranding, but I think, you know, connectivity and legibility in Sydney around what the cultural offer is like, it seems so basic and yet we can't get it right. I mean, if you go to Tate Modern on the tube, because it is a, and you don't go sort of along the Thames, that when you get off, they've simply painted the, like the electricity poles orange, and you just follow them and you get there. Like, it's so simple, you know, and yet we have something kind of loosely called the cultural ribbon, which was designed as a way of describing what the cultural institutions are, from Barangaroo through to the art gallery. But it is one of those ideas that exists on a piece of paper but doesn't actually have a physical representation in Sydney. And I frankly think that we've got to get the obvious things right. You know, the same uniform wayfinding and signage that makes the cultural institutions clear, with digital backup that shows the kinds of collections they have, and also, you know, makes it very easy for people to download a day planner where they know they can see three or four things, and, you know, and is supported not just by, I guess, the institutions, but about the right sort of business mix along the way, where you can stop and have lunch, or what else you can see, the free stuff, where there are seats
much
for you to just
like
look at the
what
harbour.
People can find on the Museums, Galleries, New South Wales trails.
Indeed.
Bit of plug for Michael there. I just wanted to comment on that and say that I think the marketing of in art galleries has gotten much more sophisticated, but very exhibition specific. I think we market really well the exhibitions and programs, but what I don't think institutions do is market their point of difference in their permanent collection. And that's really what you're getting at, is people take from the name of the institution, that's then the promise and manages their expectation of what they're going to see there. We're not very good at the moment of anchoring our brand on our collection. We anchor pretty well, I think, right now on the types of experiences you might have. But certainly for a tourist audience, that permanent collection is a big part of what they're coming to see. And we're not building that into the brand story at the moment. And I think that's a real opportunity. It's a great question.
Jodie's just referring to our website, which is mobile friendly, of course. And you can go on there wherever you are in New South Wales and find out what's nearby. If you're with Harlan on the Southern Tablelands or in the Art Gallery of New South Wales, it's what's closest and what's next closest, and you can spend the whole day following that trail. Yeah. Any more questions? There's one.
Hi, we've Alice McCullough from UTS Art. I think we've spoken about this a bit already, but I really wanted to talk more about evaluation, I suppose, especially in light of your project, Zanny. Well, you're dealing directly with students, student-age people. It's obviously a really important project for them. But how do we follow up to find out what's happening later on? And I guess it's the same with all different institutions. We can do the sort of the evaluations when they're there on the spot. But how do we keep following up to find out the bigger kind of impact what we're doing is having on people's lives?
That's a bit heartbreaking in this particular project, because I'm not allowed to see those boys again now the project is over, and we actually got kind of a bit, you know, I got kind of attached to them, and I'd like to check in and see how they're going, but now that it's over, it's quite, you know, access is quite restricted, so I can't go back. I know for a fact that one of the boys has been moved, so his room, you know, decorations have been taken down, but that's for a good reason, in that he's into a lower security jail, so that's a positive for him. One of the boys is out, so that's a positive for him. Some of them, you know, the stories are not so positive. But it's a good question, and in this particular project, one I can't really answer. I think in other ones where it's not so restrictive an environment, obviously you can, you know, find lots of ways to keep in touch with people you've worked with, and out of that could grow future collaborations and new projects, and, you know, but in this particular case, it's just, you know, a bit difficult.
I think that was the comment too of Zoe Rodriguez about the game changer, you know, that getting that small amount of money, no matter what it was a really life-changing thing for that artist, you know, and it'd be interesting to check in with that writer 5 years' time, 10 years' time, to actually start measuring it.
I should say too, I forgot to mention, someone, it's not definite, so I can't really say it, but someone's interested in buying the work, which if that happens, what I plan to do is pay an artist fee to all those boys so that when they're released, or the one that's already released, track him down, that they would get that fee. But I have to negotiate that with the jail, whether that's possible, because I'm not able to contact them directly. But something like that might be a little bonus that they get when they get out to set up for buying books or school equipment or whatever they need. So if that's how it goes through, that's what I plan to do. But it will be, a small amount. But, I guess it's also about, reciprocity, not just having a project like that that kind of, helps my career as an artist but then doesn't really do anything for them. I think it's important to think about, if I make money out of selling that work, then it should be shared with them because the work wouldn't exist without them,
I think it also comes down to the sort of funding models we have right now, that they're very project specific, and when the project ends, that's it. So you do the acquittal. But although government and philanthropic trusts are heavily focused more and more on the assessment and documentation of the impact of the project, they don't actually mean impact. They mean the short-term outcomes. There's a real difference between sort of the output, the outcomes, and true tracking of impact. Impact is a long-term issue. So if government and philanthropic trusts want us to be able to demonstrate impact, then they have to fund us for that long-term tracking. And I think that's what concerns me about the sort of measurement debate, is that there's this expectation that arts organisations are going to be able to document this, they're going to track their repeat visitation, they're going to do all the postcode analysis. Well, who's going to do that? Because right now the sector's not really skilled for that, and we haven't hired staff for that, and we haven't resourced for that. So I think there's a bit of an issue at the moment around the expectations aligning with the capability development and the funding models.
I really agree with that, but it's a bit of kind of be careful what you wish for, because I've actually argued that the City of Sydney should retain the responsibility for measuring the impact of a project, because we get acquittals and we know that they're particularly with free events. Like, I don't want to say they're full of lies, but I'm just saying that I...
Some creative license.
Yeah, and I understand why an organisation would want to stretch the truth a little bit or take the police estimate of audience numbers, because their funding depends on those numbers being very high. And so if we're living in this world where, we're asking the person whose livelihood depends on it how successful their project was, then we're kind of encouraging them to give us information that will ensure the organisation sustains its funding. So if the City of Sydney takes responsibility for that, then what that means, though, is that the funding agency will potentially, have to use that information to allocate funding to areas which are having the most impact. And that obviously, has repercussions for those who have historically been successful.
And it's about moving beyond the single institutions and working together as a sector. And how do you measure? I mean, how do you measure, the pleasure that someone gets from going to a theatre performance? Do you measure the standing ovation? What do you measure and how do you measure? And I think generally the art, what's that? Heart rates. Like that, heart rates. And the question is, I don't think we are very good at measuring. Sport and other areas can measure things perhaps a bit better, and we actually need to, we all go on about reduced resources and all the rest of it, but unless we work together, and that's why things like CAMD, and there are a lot of other, City of Sydney, I know we value that, because you don't know which free event will have that major impact on that 7-year-old or 9-year-old or whoever it is that has that life-changing impact. They've gone to a performance or something that sets them on a creative path for the rest of their life, and yet it might be full of creative lies, and we've probably supplied some of those creative lies over the years, Rachel, but you don't know what those, and it's those free events that of course are going to be the most inclusive and don't have that payback. Meredith, you look.
Foley from CAMD. We've got an even bigger problem, I think, that's arisen recently, in that the Australian Bureau of Statistics is now declining to collect any statistics on cultural issues.
It's an absolute disaster.
Yeah, so one thing I'd say is I'd encourage everybody to write to the minister and convey their, the Minister for the Arts, to convey their disappointment and indicate why this is going to be incredibly problematic. That's the main thing I wanted to say, is just to comment on that. I just think it makes it even more difficult because they were collecting that material through their general household survey. The Australia Council does continue to do those surveying. We're not doing it in the museum sector yet.
And we need to. I mean, yes. I think it's not just the big institutions. It's all those in between. You know, what you're talking about, cultural ribbon. Cultural ribbon's great, but unless it's actually all the businesses and the creativity that's happening in restaurants and shops and you know, along the street as well as in the major institutions.
We're going to have to close down now, sorry, Caroline. Otherwise, we're going to have an impact on the people who work here. Just want to thank you all for coming along. Thank the speakers. thank Jane over here for largely organising the event. And I hope that you all, or most of you, can join us at Frieda's Bar in Chippendale, where we're continuing the conversation this evening in a fairly fast-paced and maybe slightly more provocative manner.